It's time for TWiT This Week in Tech. Tim Stevens from CNET joins John C. Dvorak, Clayton Morris to talk about the latest news and celebrate the 30th anniversary of the launch of the Macintosh computer. TWiT is next.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiT.
Bandwidth for This Week in Tech is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com. This is TWiT, This Week in Tech, episode 442, recorded January 26th, 2014. You won't believe what happens next. This Week in Tech is brought to you by GoToMeeting with HD Faces from Citrix, the powerfully simple way to meet with coworkers and clients from anywhere. Share the same screen and see each other face-to-face with HD video conferencing, even present from an iPad. Start your 30-day free trial of GoToMeeting today. Visit GoToMeeting.com, click the Try It Free button, and use the promo code TWIT. And by Stamps.com. Use Stamps.com to buy and print real U.S. postage the instant you need it right from your desk. For our special offer, go to Stamps.com now. Click on the microphone and enter TWIT. That's Stamps.com. Use the offer code TWIT. And by FreshBooks, the simple cloud accounting solution that helps thousands of entrepreneurs and small business owners save time billing and get paid faster. Try it free for 30 days at GetFreshBooks.com and join over 5 million users running their business with ease. And by Squarespace, the all-in-one platform that makes it fast and easy to create your own professional website or online portfolio. For a free 2-week trial and 10% off, go to Squarespace.com and use the offer code TWIT1. It's time for TWIT This Week in Tech, the show that covers the week's tech news. And as always, we have a fun panel. We bring in, we bus them in. It's kind of like a casino. We go down, we go over to the East Bay, we say, anybody want to do TWIT? John C. Dvorak shows up in a striped shirt.
Yeah, but you're using the Great and Casino bus.
The casino bus picks him up. We give him a free lunch.
Yep, here I am.
He enjoys it. Also here, we couldn't get him to come over to the casino, but Tim Stevens is joining us.
Which way is the buffet, Leo?
From CNET, and I love, I think every tech journalist has this, the badge display over your left shoulder there, all the
trade show
badges.
It's getting all unruly at the moment. I need to organize that one of these days.
I don't know. I think that's the point, is to be a little disorganized, kind of like a... Do you have that? Do you have a tree of badges?
You know, years ago in the 80s, when I was a kid, I worked at InfoWorld, and Michael Swain did that.
Yeah.
And he had his whole office was covered with these
badges.
The
legendary Michael Swain.
And I felt it would be derivative for me to do that, so I never did. I just throw them out.
We've all done it now.
And thank God, because, I like to archive. It's a real problem with me.
Also here, Clayton Morris from Fox and Friends and the many podcasts, the gluten-free Clayton Morris. Hi, Clayton. Good to see you.
Hey, how are you guys?
Is that the... Three Rivers Stadium over your right shoulder there?
Oh, no. That's Citizens Bank Park in Philadelphia, Leo.
Oh.
That's home of the...
Not Pittsburgh. It's Philadelphia.
2008 World Series champion. Not the 2010.
It's getting to be a dim memory, isn't it, now?
Yeah.
Look at this. It's Comdex. This is from Comdex in 1984. This is the first PC magazine. It was published in 1984. Wow. And this is the third Comdex.
I thought it was published in 83 or 82.
Well, maybe it's 82. It doesn't have a date. As usual, when you do the first edition of any magazine, you don't date it because you don't know how much longer you're going to have to
be done.
You might have to sell it for months. That might be the only edition.
It came out within a year of the PC itself, so I think it was 82, something like that.
Yeah, that makes sense. Program generator does graphics and music. Look at that. That's exciting.
There's some really good stuff in that book.
February, March, 1982.
Okay, there you go.
So they talk about, this is the third Comdex, and they talk about how it's becoming bigger and bigger, 4,500 booths and thousands of people attending.
Yeah, it got bigger and bigger and bigger, and then it blew up.
It just disappeared.
That's what happens.
We brought out the old magazines because this was a big week for Macintosh on January 22nd, 1984, 30 years ago.
They had
ago.
A big party.
Yeah, they did on last night. I'll talk about, so January 22nd was the Super Bowl ad. The Super Bowl was early in those days. It was still in January.
They keep moving it. They do eventually be one March, whole year April. Of football. They're going to go to 18
games.
I like
it. I don't mind.
Players.
And then January 24th, the official announcement was at Flint Center for a shareholders meeting. And then recently, and I actually credit Harry McCracken for this, if you go to techland.time.com, Harry McCracken's blog, you could see a video that has never been seen in public since 1984 of Steve Jobs demonstrating the Mac for the first time in public. This was at the Boston Computer Society. January 30th, so it was a few
Apparently
days later.
He loves Clorox.
Of course, there's an ad. It's got to be an ad.
And a great suit to be seen.
He did look good. Did you saw it, obviously, Clayton. It was pretty cool to see this.
The double-breasted suit.
Oh, that was Tim talking. Yeah.
It was Tim. And some Chariots of Fire action, too. Spoilers. I'm sorry. Spoiler alert.
Well, because we've all seen that moment where at the shareholders meeting, he takes the Macintosh out of the bag. They play the Chariots of Fire. And then the Macintosh says, "Hello, I'm Macintosh." And that was an exciting moment. This is the kind of the replay of it.
What we're going to do is simply wait until those standards emerge.
So that's Steve talking to the Boston Computer Society.
And I wrote a mouse lesson.
Here's the Mac team all on a panel. Let me see if I could find the unveil. Yeah, here it is. This is some of the images from the Macintosh. Do you have the Chariots of Fire sound? Do we lose sound along
the way? Where's your Mac, by the way?
Now, we've been doing an awful lot.
That's the 1984 ad.
As well.
But tonight, is that me?
Really, for the second time ever, we'd like to let Macintosh speak for itself.
At home.
Hello, I am Macintosh. It sure is great to get out of that bag. Unaccustomed as I am to public speaking, I thought of the first time I made an IBM mainframe.
But IBMs couldn't do this. The graphic display, bitmapped images on the screen, all of this stuff was unique at the time. You know, it wasn't too long. Somebody in the chat room saying, you know, my Amiga was 10 times better only a year later. But this was the first time we'd seen anything like this. It's pretty exciting. And the Boston Computer Society geeks, very excited. If you want to watch the whole thing, it's an hour and a half. And what's one of the fun things is they kept the camera going after the event, and people like Woz and others were answering questions from the audience, and that was kind of fun to see Woz talking and Bill Atkinson and Andy Hertzfeld and others talking to the audience. These are people using Macintoshes for the first time. Was your first computer, Clayton, for some reason I feel like your first computer might have been a Mac?
No, my first computer, I remember sitting on my dad's lap. We had a really early IBM. I actually wrote a piece for Engadget a couple of years ago. Growing up geek, and I talked about sitting on my dad's lap while he would write basic code.
Wow!
And he was the first person in the neighborhood to have this old thing, and he was writing code, and he ran grocery stores all along the East Coast in the United States, and so he would build all these databases to manage the meat inventory for all of these different grocery stores up and down the East Coast, and I just sitting there watching him do this was remarkable, and to see then when we were robbed one time, we took our grandmother home to her apartment a few blocks away, and just in like the 15 minutes we were away from the home, someone broke into our house in Cherry Hill, New Jersey, and smashed the windows, and we pull up to the driveway and the lights are on upstairs in the upstairs of the house, and my dad said, "I didn't leave the lights on."
Oh,
horrible. So he rushes in, and instead of going like to anywhere in the house, he didn't like worry about his safety. He didn't look for like my mom's like jewelry. He ran right to see if the computer was still there. And sure enough, it was so damn heavy, no one could lift the damn thing.
Well, nor did they know what it was or know what they could do with it.
Right.
What do you remember, Tim, what your first computer was?
Yeah, it was a Commodore 64 in the 80s. I did a lot of gaming on there and learned some basic programming back in the day as well. So did a little bit of early coding back then. And I got a 286 after that a little later on. But Commodore 64 was my first computer.
Apple.com did a takeover. Happy birthday, Mac. It's funny because on the 25th anniversary of the Macintosh, Apple did nothing. And they asked Steve Jobs, why not? He said, "I don't look backwards." But now that Steve is gone, Apple...
We're going to start seeing backwards a lot.
In 1984, Apple does a lot of looking backwards, right? This is a long video. I'm not going to show the whole thing, but showing early artists who used Macintosh to create. Hans Zimmer's in this. There's a surgeon, and it's kind of cool. And then after the video, if I can skip to the end, they do a little timeline on the webpage.
Here was mine. The IBM 5150. That's what it was. I forgot.
That was a mini computer, right? That wasn't a PC, or was it?
What was the PC moniker?
That was the first PC, maybe.
There was, because they did have this.
It was 200 pounds.
Oh, that thing. Was that the box that ran BASIC and APL?
Did
it have a special keyboard?
it was a very advanced machine, but it was, and it did weigh a ton.
Yeah. Now, the first IBM was a 5150. But that was not 200 pounds.
I think it was 50 something.
Yeah. I'm not going to ask you what your first computer, John, because you used.
I used a rock.
You used them in school, right?
I had two rocks and a stick.
You were at Berkeley in the 60s.
I was at Berkeley when we used rocks and sticks. And lines.
Did you do computers then, or did you
actually? I was using a little Fortran action. I was one of those jokers. That would put obscenities on the punch cards and then go register them. And so you go look down the line and all these people were registered and there's what? Whoa, what's this? Some horrible
obscenity.
Someone
said poop on our computer.
And so I went into the lab and typed a bunch of those out and stuck them all over the place. So I started early.
We have come along. Well, here's, by the way, the Byte magazine, the first of the IBM PC, the famous cover.
Look at the thickness of that thing.
This is when computer magazines were real. There was money to be made. Look at all the ads. Yeah.
They all shot themselves in the foot. What cracks me up, I always thought was the great irony of these computer magazines. If they had just encouraged diversity instead of getting all on board with Microsoft and one thing, you know, one word processor, Microsoft's Office. By the way, Microsoft never advertised much, which was the irony of this whole thing. They essentially put all these little guys out of business and put themselves out of business at the same time.
By not buying full-page ads.
It was hilarious.
In the magazines. But, you know, I was thinking about this the other day. I mean, we really can credit Microsoft with the personal computer revolution of the 80s and 90s because they created a stable, predictable platform for developers to write software.
Developers.
Without that, I don't know if you have the PC revolution. There was a reason to have a mono.
Yeah, see, this was the logic system that resulted in the demise of the whole scene. So
that's the natural consequence, but it did certainly. I don't know. It feels like that we wouldn't have had the kind of massive.
I always wonder if we could do if there's some way just to pull Microsoft out of the equation from the beginning. Where would we be now? We could be further along.
Really?
Well, I mean, it's possible. Look at what happened when Apple came in and all of a sudden changed the phone and then the pad, which Microsoft been trying to sell all these years. Next thing you know, the iPad is like a hot product. Everyone's jumping on board. Meanwhile, Microsoft had tried to promote this back in the day of WinPad and before that, and then that more recent one, the effort, never always failed. I think a lot of their stuff is pretty junky.
Well, we wouldn't have it. I was having this discussion the other day with someone about whether or not we'd even have the success of Apple in the way that we do now if it wasn't for Vista and the debacle that was Vista.
Oh, come on. Apple was a success before Vista.
That's
wasn't
a good
it?
One.
Well, I mean, think about it. I mean, that was a real turning point.
I guess you're right.
I mean, that was a real turning point. Think about the switching ads.
Well, wait a minute.
You weren't there for Millennial.
Steve,
I mean,
Millennium Edition. The
Millennium Edition.
Steve
that was
came
bad.
Back to Apple in '98. Did the Color IMAX? That was when Windows 98 was the dominant and new version of Windows. And I think you could say Apple's return started then. Remember, it was partly due to Microsoft putting $150 million
into Apple. Yeah.
When Apple was about to go bankrupt. Remember
more
that?
Irony.
Yeah, that keynote with Bill Gates, right. The giant
and then,
Bill Gates.
And then
the
people booing him.
I am about to give you money. I feel strongly that without Microsoft providing a consistent platform, you don't have the growth of the 80s and 90s. And then, of course, what happened is you're right. Microsoft fumbled it for whatever reason. Maybe it's just the natural business cycle. And now we're looking for that platform, and we don't have it anymore. People are rejecting Windows 8.1. I don't think the iPad is a platform. It's certainly been successful for app developers, but it's not universal enough to be a dominant platform.
Okay.
I think the next platform is the cloud. But the problem is there's, you know, maybe it's Google's cloud. I don't know. But what do you think, Tim? Do you think that that's the case, that you need a common platform for success in the industry?
Yeah, you definitely do. And you also need competition. And that's the big thing. I mean, if you delete Microsoft from the picture back in the history of personal computing, then you know, that's a major player out of the equation. That doesn't force Apple to be as good as they had to be to
compete.
That's
a good point, yeah.
And so, you know, Apple could have gotten fat and lazy, and who knows what would have happened. But yeah, going forward, definitely, you know, platforms are shifting. And certainly iOS and Android are developing and becoming big. But the sort of standardization and interoperability that you're referencing, Leo, you know, the standards that Microsoft put forth and the standards of development and the sort of things that developers could target for exchanging data, those sorts of things are kind of nascent at this point still, especially when you talk about cloud computing. There's so many great services out there, but none of them talk to each other, and there's no way for any of them to talk to each other, really. There's no standards in place at all, and we're
Isn't that the promised standard? I mean, isn't that what we need?
The past five years, that's been the promised standard.
Do we need anything? I mean, maybe the days of the platform, or who cares? I use a Kindle. I read books on it. I use this for something else.
But what
I
you
use
get
my
is a fragmentation. So
what?
You get the lock-in.
Well, right. Yeah, and you get ecosystem lock-in.
Right.
No. I'm not locked into the Kindle.
What if these things shift? I mean, look at the Nook, right? I mean, would you encourage anyone to go out and buy a Nook now?
No, of course not. I wouldn't, but that's beside the
point.
How
long did that last? But you think, we're here, this is a brick-and-mortar store that I can walk in, huge right. Barnes & Noble. It's crushing all these little bookstores in the towns, right? This massive store. You can go and get coffees there. They're brilliant, right? Because you'll sit there all day and drink coffee and just keep buying books. They come out with their own e-reader platform in the Nook. This is a gold mine. It's crap.
Have you read Brad Stone's Everything Store yet?
No.
Good Amazon book.
But wait, I want to know what Clayton's what point is he trying to make?
Well, I'm saying that. I mean, how long? You say who cares about lock-in? You lock in.
No, I never said that. I said I don't see the lock-in. I see somebody else coming along with a Kindle clone of some sort that might be better. Maybe not. I don't care. I like the Kindle. It's not an expensive product, and it moves a lot of books, I'm sure. I mean,
yeah, but you got a dot. What is it? Dot Mobi file. Let's say you buy all your books on Amazon. You know.
Well, let's say I don't.
Well, let's say you do, because that,
for the
that's
sake
the point
of
why
the
should
lock-in.
I? But
well,
okay,
that's the point of the lock-in, right? I mean, right. Kindle is the most popular ebook distribution platform, is it not? So, what happens? You know, it's dot mo, you know, mob file.
It's mobi actually.
Yeah.
And yeah, okay. So I got downloaded a book the other day, and it was in the EPUB, and I just ran it. There's a website online. I just typed it in. Boom! It came out as a mobi file, and I put it on the Kindle. I read it. I don't see that. I don't feel locked in. I mean, there's all kinds of ways of getting around it. But
if you buy a first-party book, if you actually, you know, pay money for a book that you download from Amazon, it's going to be encrypted in such a way that you can't do that and put it on some other readers. So it's not so much the hardware that's going to go away, but it could be the platform that goes away. And if that platform goes away, then, you know, that content that you purchased goes away with that platform as well. And there's no way to do transfers of licenses or anything like that across these disparate
services. You have to sell the books two or three
right
times, but, I mean, that's not unusual. The whole world's been headed toward this licensed lockdown DRM crap anyway.
That's not a good thing, is it?
I know. I don't like that, but I don't think it has anything to do.
Right.
You think it should be one giant megalithic company. There's no fragmentation.
No, everybody
should be some ogre.
There's
Google.
There's definitely disadvantages to that. I'm not saying it. Microsoft, in fact, faced the antitrust lawsuit from the Department of Justice in the late 90s because of this. But we gained a benefit from it. And I'm not saying it's...
So what was the benefit specifically?
The benefit was, if you're a developer, you could write a program and have a known potential user base of hundreds of millions. The platform was not a shifting sand, although later Microsoft APIs did shift probably a little more than they ought to have. But it was a consistent platform that you could write for, and you knew you had a market. And I think that we saw an incredible blossoming of software in the 80s and 90s because of that. And I think that it's a little more fragmented now. If you're a iOS game developer, you're writing for that ecosystem, and it's not going to be on Android. It's not going to be on desktop. It's not going to be on HTML5. And so a lot of creativity and, you know, I think potentially very important software gets missed.
I think the reason for the huge boom that you talk about was because of the graphical user interface showing up, and because all these idiots who couldn't type DIR into a command line because it was too complicated.
Well, it grew the market base.
I agree. It grew the market base. This ball puts me in mind of Cannarella and Speckler's epidemiological modeling of online social network dynamics. Perhaps you read that
brother.
Paper.
Brother. Okay, if you want to shut up the audience, it's fine.
No, this is good. So basically, they say Facebook is about to lose about 80% of its users.
Good.
Because they said, essentially, it acts like an infectious disease. It's not the first time we've used that model. You know, viral video. It spreads like a virus.
I love this.
This is a great study. These guys.
It is. It feels right, right? When you're reading it, it feels accurate. It feels like, you know what? You can't really explain why your friends are not using this thing anymore and why. But it just, no one actually vocalizes it like they did with MySpace. It just, people just stopped using it.
Everybody uses Facebook and everybody hates it.
I don't use it, so that's not true.
Okay. Almost everybody uses it, and those who do universally hate it. Are there people who go, hey, by the gosh, way, I love Facebook. I cannot wait to use Facebook.
No, that's true. My wife would say that, but I don't use
it. But you have to, because that's where Aunt Maud is.
I don't use Facebook, and I hate it. So where do I fit in?
You're an outlier. You've always been an outlier.
I'm not lying at
all.
You
are not anywhere on the bell curve. You're a dot over in the upper right-hand corner of the chart.
Because where do you go? I mean, where do you go? You don't go to Google Plus. I love Google Plus.
I don't like Google Plus.
Latest version.
I love Google Plus.
No one's there.
I'm with
you. My photography friends like Trey Ratcliffe are over there, but my mom's not.
We should make that clear because people say no one's there. No, there's plenty of people there, just not the family, not your high school buddies, not the people you want to connect with. They're all on Facebook, but they don't like it any more than you do. So these researchers presume or offer as a model this disease model, and they say,
I like it.
What happens with diseases is they peak, and then they die very rapidly.
You get a fever.
And the reason is because people, well, immunization happens. People get over the disease. And so
antibodies.
So they're saying the traditional model of disease spread, they're going to update it to assume that recovery from a disease, like Facebook in the social context, means you have to have contact with a non-diseased member, a non-user of Facebook, someone who has recovered.
That would be I've never recovered.
So by contacting you,
I apparently have built-in antibodies.
They have modeled this. There's math. You could see the math.
Yeah, they got math. That
means it's true. They've got search query, data curve fitting.
Science is in.
Results and discussion. And so they say that in the next 2 years, Facebook's going to lose 80% of its audience. Now, this happened to MySpace.
I would bet serious money that that's not going to happen.
See, I don't think I buy this for a couple of reasons. The first thing is they liken this to the pattern that MySpace saw. And, of course, MySpace did have a devastating loss of active users. But the reason, or one of the reasons that they did that, was because Facebook came along and sucked them all away. There's nothing that's coming and showing up that's really showing that same potential.
But
Snapchat. What is it? Snapchat? What is the thing that all the kids are using now?
Snapchat, again, John.
Is that it?
No, the kids are using it.
Your uncle isn't on Snapchat. It's the same sort of thing, that there's nothing really that's presenting itself that's going to be replacing Facebook anytime.
Don't you think there will be? Don't you think there will be?
No, I don't think
at some point.
I don't know. I mean, if there is, then, you know, it's going to have to be something completely different than what we see today. I don't see anything that's on the market right now replacing Facebook. I mean, certainly, like Clayton mentioned, Google Plus. I use Google Plus a lot, and I like it a lot, but it certainly doesn't fit the same template that
Snapchat,
Facebook uses.
I'm telling you.
Keeping in touch with friends and that kind of thing. But the other thing is, you know, there are lots of things that have come along that have had these big booms of popularity and that didn't die out. I mean, think of internet usage. You could apply the same models to internet usage, and certainly people haven't wandered away from the internet after using it for a couple of years. So I don't see what makes Facebook fit within this model that they're defining, and other things that remain popular don't fit in. I don't see where the differentiation is.
Well, the thing is, the phrase people use is the network effect. You stay there because everybody else is there. And that, so it is there's a natural lock-in because it's where all my friends are.
I'm telling you, the kids are out. They're done.
But that's what I think that in time, that's what's going to happen, that maybe it's not Snapchat. Maybe it's Instagram. Maybe it's not Instagram. Maybe it's Vine. Or maybe it's none of the above. Maybe what is it that we need and get from Facebook?
Nothing.
Yeah, that's one thing.
Talking to the wrong guy.
Facebook providing a core service, and I don't see anything else really filling that void, like, you know, bringing all those features together, keeping in touch with your family and your friends and everything else. I mean, to me, it's more like email, and certainly people are shipping.
How hard is it to email?
People aren't saying that email is going to go away
I don't even think that people are even using it for that. I mean, I guess they're using chat services on Facebook, perhaps. But really, I think the thing that's taking off, I hear more and more people, the young kids, I hear them all around the offices are constantly talking about Instagram now in a way that I never heard them talking about it before.
Yeah.
But Facebook owns it. So, hey, kudos to Facebook for buying Instagram.
I agree with that.
Because, you know, that's all you need. It's a photo, a little comment here. You can now share directly with people individually, almost like Snapchat. So maybe the decline of Facebook
isn't helping themselves by the changing in the algorithms of the news feed either. Because what you want in the news feed, isn't it? You want to see your family. You want instead you get all these Upworthy, BuzzFeed, viral crap posts. 10 stories that prove that Bill Murray really is the most interesting man in the world. I don't want to see that. Then there's an ad for something I don't care about.
Yeah, you're the big Facebook user, so go on and bitch some more.
Then there's another video by David Berlind, of all people, amazing and powerful street guitarist.
Who cares?
Right. And then
I'm sick of these
a map
videos.
Of the known world as seen from Toronto. This is crap. A cat was left alone with a fussy baby. I was stunned by what happened next.
Play it, Leo. I want to see that.
One other thing we're learning is that people reshare these without ever watching. Louis C.K. did a great bit, which he says, all people do is they see the slide and they go, oh, cute baby, and then they move on. He said,
There's an element of that.
Yeah.
I've done that, actually.
Yes. So let's see the cat and the fussy baby. Now, they got me on the Pet Flow blog.
You're part of the problem now, Leo.
And then look at that giant banner ad floating above you there.
Yeah.
I'm glad the cat's going to put the baby.
He's going to scratch his eyes out.
You know, I can't believe what's happening next.
You won't believe what happens next.
I just can't believe this.
Jeff Jarvis says and by the way, I'm starting to see it on CNN. I'm starting to see it on legitimate news blogs. This is what's happening is they're writing headlines that tell you how to feel. Right?
Interesting.
You will be blown away by what happens next. You will be brought to tears by what this homeless man told our reporters. This is becoming.
Yeah, that's an interesting point.
The cat put the kid to sleep, by the way.
So we're just going to watch kitten videos.
And now he's transferring all his cat brain to the little kid.
Sleep! Sleep, John, I beg you!
The kid will be thinking like a cat, and he's actually infecting him. He's going to be it's probably a girl baby, and it's going to be a cat woman.
It is. It's the Vulcan mind meld.
That's terrible.
Now, how long
are you? Feeling the baby's soul.
Okay, remember. By the way, I guarantee you nobody's ever seen this entire video. Immediately, I'm going to share that on Facebook. That's good. Anyway, I think Facebook's not doing itself a service because there's all this crap on here.
Toxoplasma
going. I mean, they're monitoring all of this, right? So it must be doing well for them. Is it doing better than the crappy ads and the nonstop apps that we saw being displayed in our news feed? Is
that was
any
bad
better?
Too.
We hate it.
Facebook's the thing you hate but have to use.
I don't know.
No?
I know a lot. In fact, Burt Monroy, the famous artist Adobe
Photoshop
guy,
I was
talking over at his house, chatting with him. He doesn't use Facebook.
He invited you over to his house?
Yeah, I go over there once in a while to use his printer. He's got a big 44-incher printer,
And his bidet.
He doesn't have a bidet, but he's got a 44-inch.
By the way,
Epson.
An update on the Toto toilet. Toto has agreed to exchange the top of the toilet, so that's good
What?
There was a crack.
In your toilet?
In my toilet.
Oh, this is the $1,000, $10,000
$1,800 butt washer.
It's the $1,800 with the button RT. Okay.
Yes, it retweets.
I'm good.
Our show today brought to you, thank you. We got a great panel here. John C. Dvorak, Tim Stevens from CNET, Mr. Clayton Morris. I want to find out about the gluten-free ebook. I think it's time the ebooks did not have gluten. In them.
No, tonight only for Twit audience, it's free. I wrote a short ebook, like 35 pages.
It's free.
It's free right now. Go download it, please.
Clayton,
I would love
lost
to get,
where is it?
80 pounds.
It's called Why
on this
it's
diet.
Called why gluten free with a question mark. Why
he
gluten free?
He was grotesquely fat.
I was not.
It's crap. It's like the Susan Powder nonsense. Remember her?
No. We there were a number of people around me that had celiac, but we went low carb in our family like last year. And
is this different from low carb? Because if you don't eat carbs, you're not going to get gluten, right?
Well, no. I mean, the thing is, you'll find gluten in coffee. You'll find it in crappy coffee.
No.
Yes, you will. You'll find it as filler in crappy coffee.
Well, I don't drink crappy coffee.
No, that's not coffee. That's
what
crappy
kind of coffee,
coffee
you drinking that has gluten in it?
This I'm is like you, finding.
What are you? This no, is Dunkin' Donuts coffee.
My old No. In fact, Dunkin' Donuts does not have gluten in it. But you know that au bon pan, that that French.
Yeah, au bon pan. Yeah.
So my close friend who was celiac, it took him years to figure out what it was. Finally, was diagnosed, and he would just be in double pain constantly.
No, it was a horrible thing. Horrible ailment. Horrible.
He finally figured out, and he got off of it. He finally got off of gluten, but then he would still would have some coffee in the morning in the green room, and couldn't figure out why. Well, he was still having the stomach pain.
And it's the cheesy coffee Fox and Friends is serving.
Not anymore. Wow. Not anymore.
So really, you were getting your catering from Au Bon Pain. Uh-huh. And it had gluten in the coffee?
Mm-hmm.
He was sneaking a cupcake. No, again, that's not. There's no. So I mean, what else has gluten in it?
Shampoo? You'd be surprised to learn.
But who's eating shampoo? Nobody's eating shampoo.
And toothpaste? But, you know,
some of that banana shampoo you want to eat.
But beyond that, we're now seeing in Dr. David Perlmutter, who's like one of the leading neurologists in the world, has written a fantastic book. It's been number one on Amazon, New York Times bestseller, called Grain Brain. And all research, all science is now pointing to the fact that Alzheimer's, dementia is inflammation of the brain, can be directly tied to gluten. Yeah. And wheat allergies as an inflammation. His research is pretty overwhelming. I've interviewed him a couple of times on the show. He has been on the Dr. Oz show. It's been remarkable. And there's been a number of books on this as well. Dr. Richard Lustig's book on sugar and Gary Taub's book on why we get fat.
I love Gary Taub's stuff. And, you know, Gibson's been big on this, but he hasn't focused on gluten. He's focused just on carbs in general.
Yeah.
But gluten is like
you should listen to Gibson. He did a 25-hour show of all this stuff.
He was the longest show in the world.
My God!
But he's healthy. So it's on Amazon. Why gluten free? A simple guide to living gluten free. It's only 35 pages, and it's absolutely free. I'm gonna put it on my Kindle right now.
Well, thank you very much. Yeah,
I'm gonna go look at all the Kindles, by the way. That I have.
How many Kindles do you have? Kindles. You have to see this. He has 100 Kindles.
I could put it on any one of my Kindles. Any one of them.
Yeah, but then you have to buy a Kindle, yeah.
Exactly. I'll put it on. Should I put it on my 7th Kindle? My 5th Kindle? Yeah. How about my 10th Android? How about my 25th Android?
You're a hoarder.
My 38th Android? I'm going to put it on there. I don't even know what that is.
Where's a real Kindle on here? That's what you want.
No, the 6th Kindle, 7th Kindle, 8th Kindle.
You have a Paperwhite?
I probably do. They don't tell you that. They just say which, you know.
It just says Paperwhite on the list.
It does?
Yeah, it's when my experience.
No,
mine
no, mine
says
just says
Paperwhite.
It's an ordinal number about which Kindle I got.
You must have named it.
All right, I'm going to put it on my 7th Kindle.
I'm going to go order it myself.
Thank you very much.
Yes, it's done. It's down. Do you get credit? Are you going to go to heaven because of this? Or, I mean, is it just no money?
What's
the
name of this again?
Well, no, it's free. I think the information, it's free for tonight, and then I think
Clayton
it flips
Morris.
Back to whatever it is tomorrow.
I will read it tonight.
Thank you very much.
You have
I would,
to
my
read
goal
it today?
Was to get
is that
to
the
a,
problem?
No, you don't
have
to read
I don't
it.
Want to get this in
you
my coffee.
Read it just yet.
There's
I just want I
in
just,
your shampoo.
Oh, man.
I just want this information out there because there's so much ignorance about it, and I think it would really help a lot
Wait
of people.
Wait until my vinegar book
members.
Comes out. Same thing.
Where is your vinegar book?
I'm an idiot. I can't seem to finish anything.
The mother of all there, mothers.
Man. All right, I'm getting this right.
Let's take a break. We want to talk some more with Clayton Morris, Fox and Friends. John C. Dvorak, channeldvorak.org, and of course, noagendashow.com. And from CNET, Tim Stevens. What are you doing at CNET these days? Are you starting to do the car show yet?
Actually, I want to talk about my ebook that I have coming up. It's about how to teach your cat to soothe your baby. It's called You Won't Believe What Happens Next. And it's coming to a Facebook feed near
you. I think that's good. You know, you awesome. Put some fish sauce on the baby's forehead mm-hmm. is the key. It's the whole, it's easy.
Hey, by the way, can I just say how awesome the Twit audience is? It was ranked 1,000 in Amazon.
Yeah.
And it's now down to ranking 500 in just 2 minutes.
We cut it in half.
Holy cow.
It's free. Everybody should get one.
It'll be down to 100 shortly.
Where do you see the...
You guys are amazing. I love
you know, I'm reading this Everything Store book about Bezos and that was something they did very early on Amazon was put the author ranking, and they knew that authors would spend all day
looking at the
refreshing
ranking.
The page. Am I number one? Where am I? So do you have a special app that tells you what your rank is? Or
no, just within the Amazon store.
Oh, it's 552.
Yeah, it was over 1,000 just about 2 minutes ago.
Well, so there thank you have it.
That's very kind of you.
Sold two copies and dropped it from 1,000 to... This is
awesome.
Fantastic.
This is awesome. And as Fox Junkie said, this book tells one all they need to know if they have a question what it is.
What? Mm-hmm. What?
Yeah, that's misspelled. Thanks to
need
that.
Some work.
Please edit your reviews kindly.
Yeah, copy editing, please.
Check for grammar. Please get
this
that.
This book tells one all they need to know if they have a question what it is. I can't even read it without laughing.
John, if you write a review, please just make sure you get it spell checked.
Just spell check, please.
That's more than spell check.
Our show today, there's something else wrong there, too. Our show today brought to you by our friends at Citrix. Go to meeting with HD Faces. It is the powerfully simple way to meet with clients and coworkers anywhere. We're in the middle of a winter that is just the worst ever, it seems to me. And, you know, Comdex, half the people weren't there because they couldn't make it or they had the flu. Roads are closed. Flights get canceled. People stay homesick. But with GoToMeeting, you don't have to go anywhere. Just, you know, be prepared. Sign up right now for GoToMeeting with HD Faces from Citrix. It's an easy way to meet and collaborate online. You're seeing the same page. You could turn on the HD Faces, use your built-in webcam, and you're seeing each other in crystal clear video. Doesn't matter what the weather's outside's like. You can sign up to GoToMeeting from your computer or your mobile device and launch your first meeting in seconds. Then no matter where you are, you'll be instantly connected to your team. I even know teams that keep GoToMeeting running all day because you don't pay by the minute or by the meeting. It's one flat rate all month long. Share your screen to collaborate on projects in real time. Turn on your webcams to see each other face to face. You got to try this free for 30 days. Visit GoToMeeting.com, click the Try It Free button, use the promo code TWIT. That'll let them know where you heard it, and you get 30 days free of GoToMeeting. GoToMeeting.com, please do that promo code TWIT so they know, so we get credit. You're watching This Week in Tech. It was hard to get people last week. Nobody wanted to be on the show because of the football game, and I imagine next week we're going to have trouble again. I don't know why. Are you, Clayton, are you rooting for anybody now?
I just love a good football game. And here's what I'm rooting for. I'm rooting for a winter storm during the game.
I know. What really were they thinking?
Yeah, for now, let me say this. It's freezing here. Now, I live a stone's throw, literally a stone's throw from Rutherford, New Jersey, where the game will be played. And the whole city right now is preparing. I mean, Times Square, they're building all the scaffolding. They're building a ski slope in Times Square for the big event. They're really concerned. They're trying to get all these hoity-toity rich people to start using public transportation for the game. Today, we had a guy on the show from SeatGeek.com, and they're saying that, you know, the cheapest seats were like $2,500. Yeah, they're like an aggregator, like the Kayak of tickets.
It's really expensive, because I looked.
$2,500 for the cheapest seats, but he says in like a few days, they already dropped $1,000. Oh. And he says that you see this, it's not because, you know, the teams, he said it's not as a result of the teams or anything, that you always see this right before an event, that literally wait to the day before an event, you'll get the best possible price on your tickets the day before an event.
They got to dump, unload.
That's really interesting. So there are seats available, and some of the seats are less expensive now. The good seats are going
to
be expensive.
Who wants to go to this game when it's better on TV?
Right.
I hate
want
going
storm.
To football games.
But the reason the AFC and the NFC championship games are so entertaining to watch on television is because there's usually a snowstorm at one of the games.
Right.
It just makes it, you know, it's so entertaining.
Right.
And then when you get the Super Bowl, it's in a dome and it's warm and there's no one cheering. It's all corporate types.
It's quiet.
This, I hope, will be, you know, at least I'll get some of the excitement back.
We saw that Philadelphia game earlier this season.
Oh
my God. It was, they had
fantastic.
To snow blow the lines on the field so that people knew where the hell they were.
Yeah, they'd be playing downtown.
I was watching
if
it on NFL Red Zone, you know, the Red Zone station. So they had a quad box up, and it was all the four snow games simultaneously.
Oh, wow.
The one in Green Bay, the one in Pittsburgh, the one in Philadelphia, and it was just a whiteout. And one in Washington.
For years they had the Super Bowl in warm weather climates or domes. I don't know why they're doing it at this giant stadium.
They've decided to open it up so they can get – it's like
money.
The Olympics.
Yeah.
You know, you want to get it. So now they're going to have green. They expect to do one in Chicago.
Oh, no.
They expect to do one in
maybe even in
Green Bay.
That's crazy.
But that's the appeal of, like, the Winter Classic. You know, the hockey game they play on New Year's Day. You want to see it draws some excitement. And I think it's in an area where, you know, they haven't had the Super Bowl here. So it's pretty exciting.
Yeah. Good news for Sheryl Sandberg. She is the COO, Chief Operating Officer of Facebook. Even though Facebook's going to be nothing in 2 years.
The lean-in girl.
She's don't say girl.
She's a leaning-in.
She's a lean-in person.
Okay, she's a lean-in person.
She's also a billionaire.
Yeah,
the youngest billionaire in the country. Thanks
wow,
to
how old is she?
She's under 30.
Really? She looks like she's about
she's
40.
Around 30. She's 30-ish.
Huh?
You're such a pig, John.
What?
Don't be a pig.
I'm not a pig.
She has just made a deal also with Sony Pictures.
No.
To do a movie based on Lean In. That'll be great.
How's that even a movie?
That's going to be.
It might be a documentary.
So is Nora Ephron dead? Is she? Could she write this? Because she could make it. She could make something out of it.
I think she.
I think plucky career girl. We get, what's her name? The one with the pout.
You said the word girl.
But this is different. It's a movie.
You said Anne Hathaway. Plucky
career. Anne Hathaway. Oh,
there you go. Now you're talking.
My secret girlfriend. She would be good. But then there's no, the one who's the pouty one.
There's a bunch of those pouty ones.
I don't know.
Angelina Jolie?
No, she's not.
No, I know what you're thinking. You're thinking of Charlize? No, not Charlize, the other one.
Not Scarlett Johansson.
No, never
mind.
Who cares?
She was in Jerry Maguire. She's the one who said, you had me at goodbye or whatever it was. The studio has set Nell Scovell, the writer and director, TV writer and director, to write the script. She helped to write the book.
Renee Zellweger,
thank you. The film is not a biography of Sandberg. Scovell will hatch a narrative film from the themes contained within the book.
No, please.
She's going to be even richer. Gmail was down.
Oh.
Yahoo did a...
Worldwide panic.
Yeah. How long? Was it an hour?
Almost an hour, yeah.
Yahoo, probably not a good idea. Poked fun on Twitter.
What did they say?
Well, they just
they sent a tweet. They just said, Gmail's down. And they linked to a photo of the Gmail being down.
Yeah.
Being down, which, of course, a few
Yahoo
weeks
was
earlier.
Down for days, right?
Yeah. Right. Mm-hmm. But, you know, where does that kind of stuff get vetted in-house? I mean, here's another example of a, you know, one hand of a corporation not knowing what the other hand is doing. Be on board with your social media strategy. Who's handling that?
Yeah.
Is how high up the flag, you know, how high up the flagpole does that go?
You got to figure, Marissa Meyer. Somebody didn't run into Marissa Meyer. Said, "Can I tweet this?"
Right.
She certainly would have said no. They've got obviously a social media probably department, and they stumbled. I can imagine the call they got from Marissa shortly thereafter,
screaming.
Yeah. I always love the panic though when these sorts of things go down, and I know people get frustrated because it's for their business and they're dealing with. But think about the infrastructure that is delayed on a regular basis. The taking the train to the city on a regular basis is late one or two times a week.
Right.
Without fail.
Right.
The subway is late on a regular basis. The elevator you're waiting to get on to go up to your meeting is late. How often are you texting someone to tell them that you're running behind for a meeting because of some sort of infrastructure, being behind? So Gmail goes down and there's worldwide panic. And everyone starts to talk about, should we move off of Gmail to some other email service now?
I don't know. Did you see that? Because
I would.
And you know, Google Plus was down also. And I didn't see anybody say anything.
Nobody said anything.
So Yahoo did apologize. They said, earlier today, a tweet that reflected bad judgment was posted and has been deleted. We apologize to Google and the Gmail team. Now, that, I think, was a mistake. What? Oh my God! Tim is just
aliens
Tim
have taken
is
over.
Just falling into a hole.
Tim's using Gmail.
He's shape shifting, ladies and gentlemen.
Oh, Tim, this is sad because I want to hear what you have to say here.
But you're shape shifting.
Am I in Jordan? Hello.
This reminds me early on in Twit when you had a technical difficulty, and we ended up having you type your things, and I read them into the transcript.
You made this up.
No, you don't remember that?
No.
Oh, yeah. It was like Twit 4 or something. And it was really early on. And I remember sitting up in the cottage, up in the attic there, and we'd lost
Twit
John.
4.
Yeah, I probably typed in.
You were typing in, and I started reading your comments.
Well, I came
Let
back.
Let the record reflect that Mr. Dvorak said, eh. Never did figure out
Which
how to
Which is
spell
your imitation
that.
Of me, by the way.
That is just like him, isn't it?
No. The number of times I say eh is very minimal.
I have a whole soundboard full of eh. Tim, are you back?
I don't know. Am I back? Do I still look like a reptilian?
A little bit. The last time you were on, you'd licked it somehow. You got some new MiFi thing or?
Yeah, I'm on Time Warner now and I'm running a speed test right now and it's showing I have 30 megs down and 5 up.
Yeah, lies.
Lies.
Damn dirty lies.
We can understand you, so go ahead. And what were you saying about the Yahoo thing?
I don't know. No, I think Yahoo could have spun this by simply saying that they were trying to provide a news update to their users.
Yeah.
By apologizing, it made it look like they were trying to poke fun at Google. If they simply said, hey, we were just providing an update that
right.
we thought people would want to know. Because everybody, I mean, CNET certainly tweeted about Gmail being down. Engadget did as well. And Engadget owned by AOL. AOL has their own mail service, but nobody thought that Engadget was poking fun at Gmail, I don't think. So I think that would have been a better response for them rather than
absolutely
coming out and just apologizing.
Never absolutely. Admit it. In other words,
right. Spin yeah. it.
Spin it. Don't admit it.
Maybe they were doing that, as a matter of fact. We don't know. It didn't go nyuk, nyuk, nyuk at
they
the end.
There was no snark.
There was no smiley face.
There was no mocking of them. So for them to apologize was a little, maybe that was the social
We apologize for keeping you up to date.
I think Marissa then called him down and said, get in here. You apologized. I don't know.
Hey, she and her in her CES keynote said that they're in the news vertical, so they're just keeping people up to date on what's going on in social media. I'm curious how successful some of these new verticals have been. Do we have any sort of metrics to see whether or not this new news digest that they've rolled out, how successful that is? Yahoo Screen or any of these things they've been rolling out?
Traditionally, Yahoo does very well. Like OMG, which nobody knows is a Yahoo property, is one of the most viewed sites on the net.
Yahoo Sports, Yahoo Finance, huge.
These are huge.
Yeah, they are.
And yet, when I look at tech memes, so tech meme is where I often go to see what the big headlines are. I have yet to see Yahoo Tech on tech meme.
The Yahoo Tech stuff is lame. Have you looked at it?
Here it is. I know what you like is an SLR, asks David Polk. But then that's a side story explaining
really more general feature style.
I think David Polk, who's running this, by the way, and our friend Rafe Needleman, who's taken a job as managing editor there. I think that they've said this is going to be for more general.
I'm not sure.
Geeks.
I wouldn't be surprised if they, because Rafe is more of a techie than Pogue is. Pogue's more of a kind of
personality
and. I wouldn't be surprised if they try to do what you just, try to do something a little more techie, and they have the suits come in and say, this is a little too techie.
God knows that happened to us plenty of times on TV.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, it'd be the same thing.
Same thing.
So you have the suits come in. They don't do that to the finance guys.
Right.
But they do it to these guys. Oh, that's the way you use a weird word.
You can bet if you're doing Yahoo Finance, you're urged all the time to be more, I don't know what the word would be, technical.
Wonky.
Wonky. I would assume.
Yeah, but this, nobody's going to read this. Nobody cares about chips.
The voting is open for the first ever GIF of the Year award. See, here's the Jiffies. Here's a story straight out of the, straight off the streets.
The Jiffies?
Study walking and texting ruins your posture.
GIF of the Year?
They have study for that?
The Jiffies. Voting is now open through January 28th, so hurry. Winners will be picked with help from sites like BuzzFeed, Engadget, and Mashable. Aren't you glad you're gone from Engadget, Tim?
No comment, Leo, but take this sigh as an answer. But the expectation is definitely for Yahoo Tech to be more of a consumer-facing tech blog.
You think so? Yeah,
absolutely it is. Yeah, that's definitely the way that they're going. And I think that's something that something that a big property like Yahoo definitely needs. That they need something that's going to be providing tech news with a general consumer angle toward it. Nothing that's a little bit too hardcore. And if that's really successful, then they can kind of branch out and go a little bit more hardcore, a little bit more techy, a little bit more nerdy with the news angle. The new spin, but for now, I definitely think they're going to be keeping it at a high level.
I frankly breathe a sigh of relief because I don't want them to be techie. I want them to be.
You think everything's a threat?
Well,
you're only a paranoid character.
Only the paranoid survive, as what's his name said.
There's a lot of nice guys out there that do just fine for themselves. I would put myself in that category.
You're a nice guy.
Yeah,
yeah.
My motto is: if you have nothing nice to say,
come sit next to me.
Don't say anything at all.
This is the Jiffy's site, THEGIFYS.com. I don't think you'd ever guess that spelling, by the way.
No, I would have put either two Fs. I think two Fs.
Yeah.
Here's another one. Study. Looking at your smartphone at night can make you more tired the next day.
Is that true? What's, is that on the page?
Is that
it's
on
right above the cat jumping into the beanbag.
Is that on the Yahoo page? Yeah. Are we going to just sit here and slam the Yahoo page?
I had a caller on the radio show. I loved her. Diane from Chicago was talking about she just bought a Galaxy Note 3. One, you know, the big. She says it's 5.7 inches. I said, do you like it? She said, no, I love it like a man. And I.
What color was it?
I said, I go to bed with mine too. I understand how you feel. I don't know why I brought that
up. That's a pretty odd thing to bring up out of the blue.
I can't believe this is in there. Looking at your smartphone at night could make you
more... My friend Brian Heater wrote this story.
Now, what are you looking at?
I click on this story because, the headline is obvious.
This beanbag on a stick will change the way you think about robotic hands. Is that... Come on, talk to Brian and tell him. No. Apple reported...
Well, again, we all know...
And then there's a hardcore story.
We all know, you know, that the writer of the story very often does not write the headline of the story.
No. Exactly.
They've got some.
I would just like to point out that in 2007, Darren Murph on Engadget wrote a story about gadgets affecting lack of sleep. So I do want to say that, you know, this is the sort of study that gets picked up elsewhere, but definitely the headlines here are a little bit different, perhaps.
That's usually written by some middling editor.
The headline.
Headlines.
You know, in newspapers, you had the guy... That was like, that was his job, right?
That was that only in Murdoch papers, believe me.
Okay. So real newspapers, a copy editor would do it?
Or one of the mid-editors, a line editor, somebody would do it. There'd be somebody assigned to it. Sometimes the editor would do it.
The New York Post should, like, they were the
There was a rumor that
this.
They used to actually pay. They would, if there was a great headline like headless body found in topless bar, that guy would come out and drop $200 right in the guy's lap.
That's the greatest headline I ever saw.
That's the best headline of the day.
But it was a tabloid paper. You bought it on the way to the
subway. Still there.
There's
still
eight newspapers on the stand, and you're going to buy the one that has the best, you know, banner headline.
If you go, I always like to study, if you go to England, because in the magazine business in England tends to be oriented toward newsstand sales as opposed to subscriptions like it is here. So you go to the newsstand and you just back up and see what magazines are the most compelling. And there's some of the great headline writers are in England writing these crazy headlines. And you just gravitate towards certain things and you look at, wow.
But the British have a penchant for the using the word a clever way. Even the big billboard ads in the underground, they're always clever. Just grab you, right?
Well, that's what you want.
Puns or whatever. Our show today brought to you by Stamps.com. I'll tell you what's going to grab you. There's a new, the postage rates are going up. I can't believe this. Didn't they just raise
49 cents.
Yeah, it went up today.
So if you have a postage meter, tomorrow we'll see a bunch of people with postage meters in line at the post office getting them upgraded, or you have to pay Pitney Bowes to get it. Not with Stamps.com. It's always up to date. You always have exactly the right postage you need, the instant you need it, and you don't have to get up from your desk. You're using your computer, your printer. That's why I love Stamps.com. And you really appreciate it on those days when the post office is just jammed with people doing things like that, getting new stamps. And unlike those postage meter companies, Stamps.com never charges a fee to update postage rates. You always get the exact postage you need for any letter, any package. If you've got that great USB scale, you plop the letter or package on the scale, it prints out the label for you. It'll print right on the envelope. In fact, they'll take the address from your QuickBooks or your address book from if you're an eBay or a PayPal seller or Amazon or any one of those, Etsy. It'll automatically take the data from the website. If it's an international order, it'll fill out the international forms. It'll put your return address on there. It'll even put your company logo if you want. Stamps.com. It makes you look like a fulfillment professional. They were, just named in Software Magazine's annual 500 list, one of the great software companies in the country for 2013. So I got a special offer. Visit Stamps.com, read up, then go to the homepage and click the microphone in the upper right-hand corner. And when it asks you for an offer code, type in TWIT. You saw that $80 bonus value. You know, we're going to turn that into a $110 bonus offer. It includes a digital scale and $55 of free postage you can use in the first few months of your account. Plus, of course, 30 days free of Stamps.com. Go to Stamps.com. Before you do anything else, click the microphone at the top of the page. Type in TWIT. Do not get caught at the post office upgrading to 49-cent stamps. I still have some Leo stamps I got at Stamps.com, but they're 37 cents. That should tell you that I got them a long time ago.
Well, just put another stamp on there.
Yeah. I like the Forever stamps. That seems like a good deal. Could you make money if, like, you bought Forever stamps now and you saved them for 20, 30 years?
That's exactly what I was thinking. It's a pretty good investment these days.
Yeah, it's that's called arbitrage, isn't it? Isn't that what the technical term?
They would pull the plug on it. You get screwed somehow.
Sort of forever. So if you're a big name guy in Silicon Valley or in the tech scene, if you're like somebody who started Twitter like Biz Stone, people pay attention to what your next act is, right? Biz Stone's next act, and I haven't even played with it, is called Jelly. It's has anybody used Jelly? It's a Q&A service that you can install. I should install it on my phone.
What is it?
Yeah, it's called Twitter.
Well,
I take a picture of something and people respond. I mean,
it's kind of Twitter-like.
Yeah.
The idea is, you take a picture of something. You say, what is this? What's this flower? Oh. And you post it on your Jelly, and then people are supposed to answer.
Oh, cool.
In addition to working,
if it works.
You could forward inquiries to friends outside the app if they don't have it, which is probably likely since I don't think anybody's downloaded this. I asked people.
There were a couple of apps that popped up like this in the past 2 years that were very much like Jelly that got, they were trying to answer questions for you, and you would post questions on it, and people would respond.
This is
what
I went.
Sort of pick their brain about it. And I never knew anyone that would use it.
And by the way, they don't own Jelly.com. Fisher and Vicer does. They make
Jelly.
Jelly. You'd think Smuckers would own Jelly.
You'd think. Well, Smuckers is a little slow to...
With a name like Smuckers.
Yeah, whoever heard of Fisher and Vicer?
Well, apparently now a lot of people. They make mustard sauce.
They make all kinds of stuff. Looks very good.
It's good jelly.
Non-GMO.
So I guess it's just not enough to be Biz Stone and say, hey, I give it my seal of approval. Everybody download this app. Maybe it's huge. I don't see anybody using it.
Well, I would use it. I didn't know about it.
Maybe they need so you point, shoot, and ask. You answer with a drawing and text. Use your existing social networks so you don't have to assume. You can even forward the question to somebody via text message. Hey, I asked a question on an obscure application you don't have. Would you please download and install the application so that you can answer it? That kind of thing.
That, or I've got some code here. Where's the bug?
You know what it is? It's Quora, isn't it? Quora was such an instant hit. But still?
Quora was like sketchy because all their hits were coming from like the Philippines or something.
Oh, you think they were farming out the hits?
Well, there's a lot of companies do that.
Interesting. Intel, we talked quite a bit about Intel's television effort. They were going to do, I don't know what.
I don't know what the point of it was to begin with, but everyone thinks it's great that they sold it.
It was a big hit. The service was called OnQ, C-U-E, and Verizon bought it. They're buying the Intel media assets, the OnQ TV service. Why would Intel even create something like this? Don't they make processors?
It's a mystery.
At the center of the joint venture was Comcast, the cable company with, according to this article in GigaOm, the largest R&D team in the industry. Comcast, Verizon developed something called Nuon that was supposed to give customers an alternative to online video offerings by tying broadband, pay TV, and mobile together. Oh, this was like a grand scheme.
What's that? That Huawei box?
Huawei, this was the box, the actual hardware that would compete with Apple TV or Roku.
Well, because they came out with the NUC, which is a little box that I like a lot.
Yeah.
Since then, and that's supposed to be the same. You're supposed to do all this TV stuff, but you're supposed to figure it all out for yourself.
So Verizon pulled out of that in last August, and that killed Nuon. But now they've got OnQ. I don't know. This is these guys trying to figure out what the hell's going on. And nobody seems to know. There's no news this week.
Yeah, there is. There's plenty of news.
What happened this week?
The FCC case?
That's last week.
Well, not to me.
John just got here, so if anybody would like to explain the FCC ruling. We actually had Denise Howell on last week. We talked about it, what it meant.
What does it mean? It
means nothing.
Yeah, okay, sure. It means something to me. It means this is another step in the direction that this whole industry is headed, which is licensing people like you. And everybody who's on the internet.
No, it's terrible for people like me.
Yeah.
And Clayton.
You're totally doomed.
People who do podcasts.
Yeah, Clayton, he makes all his money from Fox.
We're dead.
Yeah, how exactly are we dead? I mean, is Twit going to fold up?
No, we're not dead. Now, in fact, I even said this. I said, this doesn't really impact us, but it does. It might slow down new people who say, I want to build a business.
It's a good thing.
I want to. I'm pulling up the ladder with the help of the FCC. If the whole issue is, of course, net neutrality and the idea that somebody like, for instance, AT&T's sponsored stories program, somebody would come along and say to AT&T, yeah, I want to underwrite any bandwidth that people use to get to my website. AT&T tells the customer, look, good news, it's not going to come cost you to go visit Netflix, let's say.
Which brings us to native advertising, which is all over these.
What's that?
Native advertising, which is a big deal right now, is and you see them. Mashable is a big native advertising
Buzzfeed.
Buzzfeed, New York Times.
What is it? Tell
CNN,
me what it is.
CNN, you can look it up.
So it's like articles that are like sort of appear as if they are content paid for.
But it's not.
With actual, right, but they're actual pieces of content, right?
You know, Forbes, right, and Forbes does this. They
Forbes
have the
plenty of them.
Contributing editor.
Well, it's not
title
even,
or something like that. Contributor title.
Yeah.
And something. Then what you realize after you've read
it's an
it
ad.
Is it's not even an ad. It's like an opinion piece that that favors this guy's company.
Yeah, it's an ad. Mm-hmm. And this is a big deal. Everyone's
That's
using
terrible.
It. And there's a company
can
out there.
Can I say
there.
We will never do this?
You can say it, but it doesn't mean anything.
We will never do this.
Well, we'll see. It's money in the. There's a lot of money involved.
Is
well,
there
you
a
actually
lot?
Well, kind of do.
You said
kinda,
there was money.
You kind of do a lot of
you
it.
Tell me there was
naturally,
money.
Naturally, yeah. There's
what
money.
What do you mean I do a lot of it naturally?
Well, you kind of do a natural form of native advertising.
Because I bring Clayton, gluten free Clayton Morris on and he
no,
did
no,
an
no,
ad
no.
For
no,
it?
He didn't pay you a nickel.
Not a dime.
But whoever is. You,
in fact, he didn't even make a nickel. He gave it away.
This is no, old time.
And you'll be 30 pounds lighter, too. So it's benefit all around.
About this.
So anyway, back to native advertisers. Now there's actually a mechanism that you can join where you give the native ad to this distribution like a double click, and they drop it in a whole bunch of newspapers all
exactly
over the place.
Exactly what Matt Cutts was talking about when he said, don't do this anymore.
Well, kind of. Although
what's he going to do about it?
He runs Google's spam operation. He could delist you. Look what
so
happened
yeah,
to all
happening.
Media.
I'd like to see him delist the New York Times.
Well, that's the thing. That's a big company that's doing this. So his Matt Cutts argument for SEO and backlinking, you know, for years, the strategy had been if you wanted to build up your blog status within Google search rank, page rank, that you would, of course, write guest blog posts on other people. You would try to get high profile blogs to allow you to come in and do a guest post. Let's say you want to write about life hacking and you contact Tim Ferriss to write something, or you maybe you reach out to Pat Flynn and you try to write something on his smart passive income blog or something like that. You try to make these connections. Well, now Matt Cutts is saying, hey, now that these companies are coming in and offering to pay for these things to happen, we're cutting it off. And this year, mark my words, is the year that backlinking strategy and guest blogging is done.
Is that
it's not going to work anymore.
Yeah, but that's different. Yeah, that's different. I don't know.
It's
how,
different. Well, it's
similar.
Well,
it's, well, go on.
Because it's, well, first of all, it's more transparent. Because you're at least seeing a sponsored, you right? On the
native advertising, it's clear that it's an ad.
No, that is not true. I can find example after example.
If you go to BuzzFeed, for instance.
All right.
Go to Mashable.
Yeah, or Mashable. And you look at, or if you're on BuzzFeed, you see this, watch 16 seconds of Nick Mangold's glorious hair. You see the featured partner.
Yes,
ad, right?
Same thing. 12 so, easy steps to throw a Grammy viewing party presented by Pepsi.
Right.
Belvita breakfast biscuits, 10 reasons why morning people always win. So these are, but they're kind of called out as ads. It says, it's in an orange, yellow box. It says featured partner.
Not always. Featured partner. What do you think that means?
How to write an old
school. Oh, it's a featured partner. Let me look at it.
Booty Jam by Carl's Jr. So. This tells me that these sites are struggling, or is it that they're greedy?
Half and half, I'd say.
Because if you start to resort, I mean, I think everybody knows this is not good for
business.
It's not good for the site. It's not good for editorial integrity.
No.
But you do it if you have to, if it's how you keep the lights on.
Yeah, it's one of the ways that a lot of these companies are making up for lost ad revenue, either because of mobile viewership, which of course is lower CPMs and fewer opportunities for placing ads. But yeah, in general, it's just a way of making more money, either making up for those losses or just being greedy in general.
Well, it's not even the greedy thing. The advertisers themselves have, you know.
They want it. I understand they want it.
Once the New York Times and CNN got on board with this stuff, the advertisers looked at the results they get from this, and it's much – they say something like three to 10 times better response rates. They are now insisting on these
ads. Yes, because they're tricking readers.
Yes.
So I'm looking at the New York Times. Where is
who knows? It's the New York Times calls it out, but it's usually deeper in the – it's not on the – I've never seen
it. It's not on the front page.
At least not that I've ever seen.
And, fashion and style. It'll be on fashion and style, right?
Probably.
Right? That's
a good guess.
Yeah. Let's go to fashion and style. So it would say written by or...
Yeah, written by CEO of some company.
Yeah. It seems to me...
I think I've seen that on Business Week, right? You're seeing... Yeah, CEO of some company.
It seems to me that this is a sign I think you're right, Tim. I don't think it's greed. I think it's
desperation,
and that's a little worrying, isn't it?
There was a huge uproar when The Atlantic ran an editorial from
Dave
Miscavige of Scientology, and that's basically exactly what was going on here. You could think of that as being basically a guest blog about Scientology, and that was, of course, you know, very poorly labeled as being an ad, and it was very ugly and had a huge negative impact on that. You know, that story publication has gone back for so long, that's so many people respect, and they definitely crossed that line there. And there are so many other companies now that are like, oh, well, if The Atlantic's doing it, then I guess it's okay that we can do it as well. And to me, it's definitely sad to see.
I think you're right. I think it hurt their brand, and that is a storied brand.
Yeah, it's sad, but then you see the rise of paid journalism, like what Jessica Lessen is doing. So I don't know. I think the market affords these types of things, and it people kind of can pay with their dollars. They can decide if they want this kind of a thing. They're going to pay for Jessica Lessen's type of journalism with her team, or you're going to settle for the kind of stuff that you're seeing what Tim was just referring to on The Atlantic. And I think that's exactly what Matt Cutts is getting to as it relates to even just bloggers, not even just like large scale Mashable and BuzzFeed, which is, you know, if we want to make the internet maybe a better place for content so that it's that these blogs, maybe you've come to love and respect, are actually putting out quality content that are great pieces. You know, like I said, if Pat Flynn writes a really great piece on content strategy, that's great. And that brings real value to the internet. But if someone's paying for that and then sticking in content somewhere as a guest blog post just to get backlinks to their website, then we all suffer from it.
Well, the reason these things work, whether it's acknowledged or not, is because they're essentially fooling people. That people read it thinking it's editorial, give it greater weight than they would if they knew it was an ad.
Right, that's actually exactly what the problem is.
It's about tricking people.
Yeah.
And I think when any brand starts doing that, they really cheapen the brand. Now, I agree with you, Clayton. The market will end up, I hope this will end up shaking out. And you do see some really interesting moves towards paywalls with Jessica Lessen. It's $400 to get the information a year. I paid for it. I'm not sure. I love Jessica's stuff at the Wall Street Journal. I think it's an interesting move for her, and I'll watch with interest to see how she does, but I'm not sure if the content is so compelling that it's worth $400 a month. But maybe that's because I'm not an investor. You look at Recode, which is Kara Swisher and Walt Mossberg's recasting of All Things D under their own brand.
Right.
You look at what Ted Greenwald is doing, the guy who broke the Snowden stuff. Pierre Omidyar is giving him, I don't know how many millions of dollars.
250, supposedly.
The same amount Jeff Bezos paid for the Washington Post, $250 million dollars. To create, I don't know if it's a paywall. Is it ad-supported?
We don't know yet.
This stuff doesn't bode well for ad-supported.
We don't know.
Andrew Sullivan.
Sullivan's actually done okay.
And he says he's making $800,000 a year.
No, their numbers are six. But it's still good money. $600,000.
Like a team of four people working for him now, too?
He's got to pay them.
See, now, $600,000, if you've got five people to support, is not much money.
Maybe I forget the number. Maybe it was three. I don't quote me on that, but I think he is doing pretty well.
His is a paywall. You have to pay to see it, right?
Yeah, it's a reasonable price. It's not $400.
And he claims he has, I can't remember, was 30 or 40,000 subscribers.
600,000.
Yeah.
Or so.
So I'm glad to see all these models. I don't have any problem. So it's $20 a year. It's a tip jar. It's not payment.
It's a subscription.
34,000 subscriptions generating more than 875,000 in revenue. He'd set a goal for 900,000.
So I think it takes out $2 a month or something like that.
Not too bad.
It's weird. I keep logging in on my iPad to try to read. I'm still paying for it. I try to read the daily every day. And I don't know what happened to it. I keep trying
they
to log
it.
In. Is that what happened?
Yeah. Are you joking? You're joking now. That's Rupert Murdoch's 99 cent a week. Yeah. He hired 100 journalists.
That was dead on arrival. Come on.
Well, I mean, it was flawed from the beginning because you're hiring, hundreds of people and you're throwing, millions of dollars at something.
But I like to see the experimentation.
I love the idea. I did too. And I was excited about it. I think my wife and I both subscribed to it. But then when I started seeing that most of the articles were just repurposed a lot of them were like repurposed Associated Press articles. I'm like, I can get that in 8 other apps that I have, I want to see original content.
Horowitz and I'm sorry. Horowitz.
No, they tried some interesting things there. They hired like some, during the Mississippi flooding, they were actually the only company that they had it. They hired a drone and they actually had aerial pictures of the flooding when no other news organization did. So the Daily was trying some things. It just was, I think, a flawed platform.
Horowitz and I on the DH Unplugged stock market podcast we do once a week. We're going to put a paywall up for the second half of the show where we have, our kind of our discussion of actual stocks, and it's going to be like
I always thought that there were some things that you could do where you could charge money if people made money, for instance.
Well, yeah, it doesn't take much, and so I think the stock thing, and that's why I think the Wall Street Journal did well when it first put up its paywall, but then after a while it started to fail.
I mean, doesn't it just come down to value? If you're bringing real value to people on a consistent basis, Leo, to your point about Jessica Less and stuff, maybe because of the investing angle, it might not be as valuable to you. But if you're bringing that
others
value,
might find it.
It might be making them thousands of dollars. So $400 to them is nothing.
Right.
It's a question of who's paying, too. If you look at Jessica Less's content, there's a good chance that a lot of her subscribers are actually being paid by their employers. They're able to expense that expense, $400 a year. Whereas, the Daily was a personal expense for a lot of people. So, if you cross in that threshold where this is a professional expense, something they can write off their taxes or something they can get their employer to pay, then obviously that boundary, that threshold of what's acceptable goes up a lot higher.
So, apparently, maybe part of the Gmail bug, but thousands of emails were being sent to David Peck's Hotmail account.
Nice. It's a new denial of service.
It's a bug in Google search. TechCrunch found this out. Sarah Perez wrote about it, which is pointing users directly to David Peck's email address. So if you open the Compose window on Gmail, you get autofill. But apparently, for some reason, his email is the first that pops up.
You don't
up.
Think this is fishy?
And his address, which is DSP559 at Hotmail, I'm sure it's long ago. But nobody, and TechCrunch says none of this is in our address books, but it's been filled in. Another Google search surfaces who this address belongs to, David S. Peck of Fresno. He says he's been receiving thousands of emails, the majority of which are blank. 500 an hour. I can't stop them, he says.
I can't stop them.
Better hope that
500
you
an hour, that's a lot.
Yeah.
Just kill the account, hell with it. That's what I do.
A Google person says, spokesperson says, due to a technical glitch, some email addresses on public web pages appeared too prominently in search results. We fixed this issue and are sorry for any inconvenience caused to David S. Peck of Fresno, California.
I'm telling you, somebody was out to get David.
Or David was messing around, possibly.
Turns out he wrote one too many guest blogs, and that's how Google got back.
Yeah.
Matt Cutts meant it when he said, I will cut you off. We'll talk about the Great Firewall of China heading all of its traffic to a little town in Montana, I think. That was another strange thing. But first, a word from FreshBooks. If you are a small business, you know that probably the worst time of the year, or the month, I should say, is the end of the month when you got to do your invoicing. I always hated that. If it's you if you're using Microsoft Word or Excel to do your invoices. Do you have a shoebox of receipts that keep track of your expenses? Right about now, you're digging them out, right? Tax time's coming. How about in 2014, turn over a new leaf and save time, get paid faster, keep track of all your stuff with FreshBooks. the easy way to send invoices, manage expenses, track your time. It's a cloud accounting solution that is so simple. I actually started using this in 2004 when I was invoicing a bunch of different people for work I was doing, including Rogers in Canada, and I had different currencies. I had to do Canadian dollars. Amber MacArthur said, try FreshBooks. It's with this new thing. I loved it. Easily create invoices online, capture and track expenses on the go, get real-time business reports with a few simple clicks. You'll get paid faster. There's even, if you and your client agree, you can have the invoicing and the payments automatically done by FreshBooks. There's even a Pay Me Now button in the email FreshBooks sends out. I mean, it's just really, really great. Put your business in the palm of your hand. Free for 30 days at getfreshbooks.com. And here's a little way FreshBooks is thanking Twit listeners who join up. Make sure when you see the how did you hear about us, you write This Week in Tech. Can they write Twit, Lisa, or just This Week in Tech? Write This Week in Tech just for safe, because I want you to be in the drawing. Every day they're giving away a birthday cake to somebody who signs up and says This Week in Tech for a new account. Getfreshbooks.com. We've had the birthday cake. It's really good. It's not just like some, you know, grocery store cake. It's a really good cake. Getfreshbooks.com. So apparently there was a misconfiguration. We think it was in the Great Firewall of China that put as many as 2/3 of the country out of action for several hours. Now I have to sign up for the Financial Times to read the rest of this story. Gosh darn you paywalls!
Let me see if that stinks.
Let me see
if the system works.
So what does everybody do? You go to another source that doesn't charge.
You know what? Here's how I'll give you a trick for people out there that never thought of this. Take that and just clip the headline and put it in Google.
Yeah.
And boom.
And you find it.
Because nobody ever rewrites headlines.
Right.
And so, bang, you get it. Like,
so, apparently, I would guess it was one of their big routers. It was redirecting all Chinese DNS traffic to this small building in Cheyenne, Wyoming.
Wow. Who owns the building?
Perhaps the biggest failure in internet history. So, this company, this is basically a front.
For what, the CIA?
No.
NSA?
No.
The Chinese?
You know how when you have a company and you can have somebody in a for instance, in Delaware, we have a registered agent in
Right,
Delaware.
And you got a guy, and there's a little office.
It's a little office, and all of our corporate mail goes there because we're a Delaware corporation.
Somebody picks it up once a month.
So apparently, Sofidia, which is something a little shady, a company that is based on paper in this Wyoming building, perhaps is... Well, it's controlled, they believe, by jailed former Ukrainian prime minister.
Uh-huh.
And it's a company charged with helping online poker operators evade gambling bans. Anyway, it's a very... This is from the... this is actually a better article anyway, from the Bits blog in the New York Times. Apparently, what happened was the people who run the Great Wall of China, one of the things that they do is they block sites. They block Twitter, they block Facebook.
Right.
They also block... proxy services that people use to get around the Great Firewall of China.
Right, and VPNs.
Technologists surmised that the Chinese internet censors were trying to block traffic to Sofidia, but mistakenly redirected all traffic from China to them.
Nice.
they flipped a bit. And instead of, you know, the rule says nobody can go there. Instead, it said everybody must go there.
That's interesting.
Hey, that helped. The population is 61,000 people in Cheyenne. I've never had them.
Some way of making money off that deal.
It just shows you, you know, the internet's too complicated for humans. Anyway, it was only a few hours. I know. Nearly every Chinese user and internet company, including Baidu, which is the Google of China, was brought down. Actually, it was up to 8 hours last Tuesday. Most of China's half billion internet users could not load websites, including Baidu and Sina.
There's been a lot of these weird things going on.
Yeah.
Like Omaha. Do you hear about the city of Omaha, Nebraska, after Peyton Manning was yelling at that game a few weeks ago? Omaha. I mean, he was
yeah, like, that's his. That's an audible. In fact, they often use cities for audibles. I hear that all the time.
So Cheyenne and Omaha were like trending for odd reasons.
Why does Peyton Manning keep shouting Omaha?
So the city of Omaha, like the Chamber of Commerce, they jumped on it. People were retweeting it like crazy. Oh, they jumped on it. So all these ad revenue. Their hotels have been selling out because people are going to Omaha. I'm like, really? People are flying to Omaha? Because he mentions it during a game.
You know,
he mentioned it quite a bit, actually.
Speaking of the NFL, who owned the internet this week?
Yeah.
Who was the guy?
Richard Sherman?
Yes.
What about him?
Seattle Seahawk, Richard Sherman. If you watch the Niners Seahawks game at the very end,
he freaks.
It was bizarre. The line reporter asks him, you know, what did you
Aaron
think of that
Andrews.
Last Aaron Andrews? What did that last play? I could play a little bit of it for you. It was just bizarre.
They actually cut away some. There was a decision made in the booth that either stay with it because this is good TV, or cut away before he starts cussing.
And what would you have done?
I would have cut away because
props to Aaron Andrews. Problems.
Because
she handled it great.
She did not freak. I would have freaked.
She had a grimace. She had one of those looks on her face, at least.
She's like, oh, this is... Because you know, I mean, in broadcasting, you guys, I mean, you know, something's going south real fast.
Oh, it went south. You know, here, let's just watch. Are you getting my video, Chad? All right, let's just watch. This is after the game, right after the game on the sidelines, Aaron Andrews talking to Richard Sherman.
I'm the best corner of the game.
Wait. Let's get her question.
No, the question comes later.
Take me through it.
Oh, yeah.
Well, I'm the best corner of the game. When you try me with a sorry receiver like Crabtree, that's the result you're going to get. Don't you ever talk about me.
Who was talking about you?
That's the best question. Don't you ever talk about me. Who was talking about
it? It was very funny.
Her eyes get really wide.
Yeah.
And then they do cut away, which is too bad because you know there was more. Actually, I think he walks away.
Are you on the center for you real quick?
No, they cut away. They cut away right there.
They cut away.
She says, all right, guys, back to you.
So I think, do you think? Was this, now it's possible this guy, you know, it's a big game. He was fired up. He just lost his temper.
You don't watch much sports talk.
It's trash talk. But you don't usually do it on camera to the networks. You do it.
This is all these sports talk radio and sports talk TV and ESPN talked about all week.
That's okay. So that's the other theory, is that Sherman knew. He's a very smart guy. Went to Stanford. Very smart. Very well spoken. He knew exactly what he was doing. He got in a Twitter battle with Crabtree, right?
What profit was it for him?
Because he's famous.
He's been famous.
Well, he's even more famous.
I mean, who among us gets to play in a game like that, right? A championship game like that. And you block the pass that could have sent the 49ers to the Super Bowl.
Yeah.
He literally walks off the field right after that moment. That was the end of the game. Comes right to the sideline. He's still freaking out, charged up. So if that just happened to me, I don't know that I would have been able to calm down very calmly and just said, well, Aaron, thank you very much for the question.
That's
you
know, actually what all the sports guys said.
The
guy said everyone gets so worked up at that game moment, especially after something like that, he just kind of lost it a little bit.
Part of it. I think that may be 50% of it. But
he said later that he was called a thug. He said that's just a racial epithet, basically. That's an acceptable way of using the N-word these days.
Yeah.
I think he's a smart guy.
He's using this as a publicity stunt?
I think that the Twitter battle back and forth between him and Chris, he owned the internet for a day.
I'll tell you what.
More than the Great Wall of China.
There were more tweets on Richard Sherman than anything else during the week, I think.
Exactly.
Here's why I think that was, if you're right, this was a huge mistake and a bad decision.
Why?
Because what he's managed to do, especially after that, the choke signal and all that stuff, he drew so much attention to himself that you have to know that the referees in their pre-game meetings are going to say, we better keep an eye on this guy. And they're going to keep an eye on this guy. And he's a major holder. He likes to hold the receivers. He does a lot of pass interference. He gets away with a lot. He is going to get called for at least two or three penalties that otherwise may not have been called.
I also have to wonder what his teammates think. You know,
they don't care. They think that's just Richard.
That's the way he is.
But that's just, you know. So I think that Peyton and his boys are going to win that game.
I'm moving to South Korea. I'm just saying it now, and not because
so you can be closer to your North Korean relatives.
Yes. Because two things. First of all, they're now getting a 300 megabit LTE in Korea. Korean carriers are going to launch a new LTE advanced network that will get 300 megabits down They're going to aggregate three bands together, and they say, hey, later on, we're going to go to 450.
Now, Tim, correct me if I'm wrong, but isn't this the country that has like the largest population of internet addicts? They have like clinics set up all over the country.
Oh, absolutely. They have camps that they send their kids to who can, you know, when they can't get off the internet, they can't stop playing StarCraft. They'll get sent away to camp for a week or two. And
was that apocryphal? The guy whose bladder burst because he couldn't stop playing StarCraft?
I believe that was there as well. Yeah. It's, it's a very passionate country full of passion for mostly StarCraft, but also for downloads and a hate for pre-installed apps, which is great. I think that's something we can all aspire to.
By the way, Sherman did get fined over $7,000.
$7,000. No. Not for that.
Not for that?
No, after the play, remember he put up his hand.
The choke.
Yeah, he did choke.
He did that. That was on the
field. But he also came up to Crabtree and tried to shake his hand.
That's bull crap. He was yakking at him, and then when they threw the flag on him doing the choking sign, then he held his hand out to make it look like he was doing something else. That was bull.
All right. The other reason I'm moving to South Korea, South Korea rules.
Yeah, I'm a football fan.
Yeah, I guess so. South Korea rules pre-installed phone bloatware must be deletable. Why can't we do this?
That means no Samsung Galaxy phones will be able to be sold there.
I just saw a graphic that showed how much free space there is on a 16-gig phone.
None.
Mm. And it's literally half of it on a Samsung Galaxy S4 is taken up by bloatware. Half of it.
Well, you need that golf photography mode.
Yeah. That's the one I always come up with. I don't think... You must play golf, though. You look like you play golf.
I used to play, but I hurt my back. It's like the worst thing in the world you can do for your back. But even still, even if I did play golf, I couldn't imagine. I mean, the golf swing camera. Yeah, the rare use case that you would get from that camera mode. Hey, Dad, I want to get this. I actually have a mode on my camera that can elegantly get your swing.
The S4 has 80 apps pre-installed, 25 loaded in Korea by the telco, 39 by Samsung, 16 from Google. There it is. There's the graphic. Mm. And the least intrusive is the iPhone 5C. You get 12.6 free megabytes on a 16-gig phone. The worst is the S4. You get 8.5 megabytes free.
Gigabytes.
Yeah, that would be bad if you had 8.5 megabytes. That would not be good. The Nexus 5, I'll give you the list in case you want to know. The 5C, the Nexus 5, the 5S, the Sony Xperia Z1, the BlackBerry Z30, the HTC One Mini, and the LG
Zed?
G2. I'm going to call it Zed because in honor of my Canadian friends.
Bravo.
Z is not a good word. It's Z.
That's what they do in Europe.
Yeah. Don't you think? Z? What kind of word is Z?
When you get hurt, do you go to hospital?
You go to a Z hospital.
Well, a Z, that would be different.
Anyway, I'm moving
to Korea, interesting,
so I don't have to worry
implication
about this.
Of this South Korea ruling, which is that it's not only the stuff that we don't want, it's the stuff that we actually do want. So things that like Gmail and Google Maps, Google Navigation, even potentially Siri, those things could also be covered by this ruling too, which could mean some pretty extensive changes to these mobile operating systems to be able to rip those things out, much like Microsoft had to rip out IE from I think it was Windows 95 back in the day.
Well, they're not saying, though, this is important. They're not saying it has to get rid of it. Just you can uninstall it if you want to.
Right, but there's no way to uninstall Siri right now.
Right.
So that would be a pretty big change for iOS, I think. And, of course, Apple wants to be present in South Korea. So how exactly they're going to draw the line between, you know, quote-unquote bloatware and application or iOS functionality, that remains to be seen. But certainly those things are apps, and so you should be able to uninstall them as well.
Ken from Chicago in our chat room says non-techies actually like bloatware. They see it as free software. I don't think that's true.
I think Siri would be considered that. I think there is some. I think there's a difference.
Siri is,
but free software is one thing, and crap that they put on the phone is another.
Right.
And it's pretty obvious. It's like porn. You can tell it when you see it.
This was a big problem on PCs. That's why Microsoft created signature PCs, because Windows would come from HP particularly, but it would come larded
with crap,
trialware.
Yeah, which is worse because it's not even fully functional.
Right. McAfee for 3 weeks or something. This news just breaking, Google and Samsung have agreed to cross-license each other's patents for 10 years. So Google and Samsung it was Apple that was the problem, and Microsoft a little bit too with this Rockstar patent troll that they had created. Google and Samsung, obviously, in the Android camp, so they have agreed to license. So if you were worried about the threat of lawsuits, worry no more.
I've never bothered me.
Never bothered me either. I don't, this is the worst week for
us. No, so we've had every story that you've talked so far about, which is a funny construction, has been fantastic.
There's the Qualcomm patent buy from HP. I thought that was pretty interesting.
What did they buy?
They bought a lot of patents from Hewlett Packard, including the old iPac brand from back in the day, but
the
also
iPac.
A lot of the
that was a compact. The Palm.
Wow, yeah, the iPac
as well. So they bought iPac and Palm. So a lot of patents related to mobile devices, which is interesting because Qualcomm just released the Talk, of course, which is, you know, they make components, but it's not too often that Qualcomm makes an actual device. Now they bought a bunch of patents that all relate to devices, which makes me wonder if Qualcomm isn't going to be making more devices in the future.
That's a good one.
Well, also interested in Netflix, too. And
they want to have a three-tier payment plan. Is that right?
Yeah. Three different tiers. Yeah, I mean, it's...
But new for new people only.
So, right. So it would have... Well, they have 44 million members right now, which is pretty mind-blowing.
Wow.
And you think about what they've... And you think about the awards that they were able to get at the... at the Golden Globes,
yeah,
right? You had some of their programming winning Golden Globes.
Orange
for the
is
first
the New
time,
Black was nominated. Kevin Spacey's House of Cards was nominated. I think one.
Yeah, they're coming back now for multiple seasons.
Great stuff.
Yeah, so it'd be interesting to see the different stream variants that you could pay for and get. I don't know that people would be really aware though what they have in their house and what they would want to pay for.
And this is a part of the cord-cutting thing that's taking place. Of course, you have a show or did. Or
we did, but we want to launch a new one because I think this is a big story.
And I should mention this. Yeah. I had a professional finally. I've always had a big fan of Over the Air, which broadcasts. So I finally had some guy come over and put an antenna up on the roof.
Now, you live near enough to Oakland and San Francisco that you could probably get Over the Air signals.
You don't have to be that close. You can
most of those towers are on Mount Sutro in overlooking San Francisco.
I have one of the best shots at it. That's true.
You can see it from your house.
I can. But that's beside the point because most people have good access to Over the Air if they want to try it. But the guy says nobody, you know, it's picking up a little bit, but nobody's doing this. They're going along with complete cord cutting and they're not going.
Or they're paying $100 a month for cable.
Or more. So what do you think? So I had the thing, I pushed it on, hit the button to go scan the channel. How many channels do you think I get over the air? HD over the air
in the San Francisco Bay Area.
Yeah, what do you think?
No, many more than that because, like, Channel 4, Cron has like five different sub-channels.
They have three.
So you get HD1, HD2.
They have two.
They have old Honeymooners reruns, like 24/7.
87 channels.
87.
Whoa.
Wow. How many of those would you watch? How many of them are in Korean?
Many are in Japanese, Korean, Chinese, and Vietnamese.
Just checking.
The guy says to me, he says, these guys can buy these. He says, he knows it's a
cheap.
Good. Yeah, you can buy a channel cheap, and it's a good way to communicate with your community.
Yeah.
But 87. Anyway, I'm just saying, people get an antenna, get a little tuner, see what you got there. You'd be surprised.
I want to mention Squarespace.com, and we're going to wrap it up. I want to talk about why we can't say the word candy anymore. But first, a word from the best place to go if you want to create a website, Squarespace.com. I think you have a Squarespace site, Mr. Clayton Morris. I do believe.
You know, we have one at the noagendashow.com.
No Agenda Show. In fact, last time we were here, we tried to bring noagendashow.com. We couldn't bring it down.
You went out of your way.
Let's bring Clayton's site down. What is your Squarespace?
Well, I'm actually redoing it right now.
Oh, look at this. He's chickening out.
No, I'm working on it. Photographybegins.com.
This is cool. Are you going to do a...
photography site?
Yeah. I've had it for a while. It's being totally overhauled right now and working on a podcast with it and for total beginners. So I've been.
What a good idea. What a good idea. And you're shooting the NEX-7.
Yeah, the NEX-7 about to play with the Sony AR-7.
A7R. I just got A7R, that.
You did?
Yeah, I just bought that.
Can I borrow some of your cameras once in a while just to play with?
Yeah.
But yeah, it's up and running. I think I've been on Squarespace now. This is Squarespace 5, Squarespace 6. I've never, ever had a problem.
Everybody go to photographybegins.com right now. If all...
Yeah. You can't bring these sites down.
5,000 of you watching right now, go there. You can't bring it down. You chose Squarespace because it's easy to build a website. It's affordable to build a website. You start with 20 beautiful templates. If you want a site that looks great, if you're a photographer, an artist, It's great for a portfolio because you want your site to be gorgeous. You want your site to express your aesthetic. But at the same time, you don't want to become a web developer. You don't want to learn JavaScript and CSS. Well, you don't have to. Squarespace gives you the tools you need to make your site gorgeous easily. And of course, it never goes down. That's a nice feature. You get hosting and software. They've got their new Squarespace Metric app. I don't know if you've tried this yet, Clayton. It's iPhone and iPad ready. It lets you see the site stats in real time. Page
yeah,
views.
I've been using it recently.
It's so great. Cool. Unique visitors, social media follows. They've got a great blog app too. These guys are good. The code is gorgeous.
And with their responsive design, design, I mean, you can look at the, you know, your site traffic and the metrics, and you know, an overwhelming number of the folks that come to my site are coming from mobile.
That's important thing to know.
Yeah.
And your site looks great on mobile. In fact, what's nice is it's not a mobile site of your site. Your site looks great on all size screens. And that's really what you want. You don't want to have a different site because you're on an iPhone. You want it to look great on all size screens. You can try it free. No credit card needed. Just go to squarespace.com, and you'll see the Get Started button. Browse around a little bit before you do. They do have wonderful help. They have forums. They have webinars. They can, you know, workshops to make you better at it. All of that's free. Their support comes from the Squarespace offices in New York, so it's really good. These are the engineers who actually do work on it. When you decide to sign up for Squarespace, make sure you use the offer code TWIT and the number one, TWIT1, and you'll get 10% off. And they'll know that you saw it on This Week in Tech. That's TWIT1 to sign up for Squarespace. It's free, and you don't even need a credit card to try it. But if you decide to buy, get 10% off. And get that annual plan. As little as $8 a month, you get a free domain name. They've got e-commerce. I mean, I think anybody who watches this show knows we love Squarespace. Squarespace.com, offer code TWIT1. So Candy Crush Saga, anybody play that?
My wife admitted that she was addicted for a while.
Yeah, they've trademarked the word candy.
Come on,
come on. They got the trademark, and they immediately started issuing takedown requests for any app that had the word candy in it. But apparently,
you're asking for trouble.
It's not even just apps. It defends against clone titles, which I think is legitimate. There's a lot of clone titles. But I think they got it even more broadly than just apps. So who knows? You may see.
This won't last.
Really? It seems like a generic word. Apple actually admitted the takedown request on King's behalf. I guess that's part of the mechanism if you have a trademark.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, that's a fascinating story.
Well, they're just going after app. They're just going after apps. They're not going to go after.
I hope so. I think it also covers pizza parlors, but I'm not wrong. I'm not sure. I think there's more to it than just apps. But you wouldn't want to name a pizza parlor. Did you see the guy? We had a long debate on this This Week in Google about the guy who wore glass into a movie, an AMC movie theater. Now, in his defense, he has prescription glasses with Google Glass attached.
Yeah.
In Columbus, Ohio. He's sitting there halfway through the movie. A guy flashes a badge at him, says, come with me. Oh, grabs the glass and says, come with me immediately. Turns out it's the Department of Homeland Security.
Yeah, that's weird.
Well, I don't think so, because I think ICE, which is part of DHS, is the defense copyright and trademark and stuff like that. They're the copyright police now. Because, you know,
so they're working for the
MPAA.
Is okay,
a form of
sense.
Terrorism.
Yeah, no, it is totally a form
and then
of terrorism.
Then he says, I'm wearing Google Glass. I can only record 8 minutes at a time.
Yeah, and then it craps out.
Right.
He says, I said, get hook up the glass. Here, take the glass. They took his phone. They took his wallet. He said, look at what's on my phone. Look at what's on my wallet. It's just pictures of my dog and my wife.
And what movie was it?
Jack Ryan.
Oh, yeah. Everyone wants to record that.
Shadow Recruit. He says, what followed was over an hour of the feds telling me I'm not under arrest. This is a voluntary interview, but if I choose not to cooperate, bad things may happen.
Yeah.
Did they reimburse him for the cost of getting his butt yanked out of the movie?
Well,
time and money.
They gave him four passes to a future film.
Four?
Yeah.
For one? Okay, well, that seems reasonable.
Seems fair.
Yeah.
They didn't really want to look at what was on the phone on the glass. They questioned him.
Because they didn't know how to do it.
for an hour wanting to know who I am, where I live, where I work, how much money I'm making, how many computers I have at home, why I'm recording the movie, who am I going to give the recording to, and why don't I just give up the guy up the chain because they're not interested in me?
Should have said it was Janet Napolitano.
Eventually, after a long time, now this is all the account of the perp. Not, perp. So we don't know. But eventually, well, you know, these guys are all innocent.
I believe it. Eventually, well, he didn't do anything. And in fact, Clayton's right. He couldn't have recorded it with that thing anyway. It records like, you know, it craps out within
a few
minutes.
But don't you think, okay, well, this is the conversation we had on Twig. I said, yes, of course this is overreaction, but the theater owner have every right to throw him out, just as they would if he were holding up a camcorder or even his phone and recording. That's illegal. And
so you took the side of the government on this.
I did, because frankly, wow, if you're going to be a glasshole, you should expect this kind of treatment.
Well, if it was Scobel, maybe. But except for that one.
I just don't think you should wear, you should be, if you're going to be on the cutting edge of this stuff, understand people's sensitivity.
What's sensitive? Clayton said it. You can't record the movie anyway with the device because it just doesn't, it's not equipped to do that. And what kind of a recording? What, are you going to sell it? Say you could record the whole movie. Some crappy movie that's every time you turn around and look at somebody next to you, you get to see that.
Well, but we know that happens. People sell those.
Oh,
we hear the guys breathing in the background the whole time.
Yeah, right. These sorts of movies aren't sold that often.
Anyway, you can always get the Academy screener, and what do you need that for, right? Just sell that.
Yeah, you can get this screener.
It is a Kramer move.
Right.
I just feel like I feel like people who do. You, any of you have glass? Tim, do you have glass?
I had glass for a long time, yeah, but I certainly made a point to never bring it into the movie theater. Yeah. I also made sure that I took it off if I ever went into the men's room, just to be, you know, to be conscious and be aware of those sorts of situations. I didn't want to be, you know, I didn't want to create a scene. I didn't want to create any issues. The only time that I wore glass that I was a little bit unsure about was through airport security, but I actually wanted to see what the reaction would be through airport security, and actually everybody was fine in that case, and I checked my rights before going in there, and right, I knew that I could do that legally, but certainly going into a movie theater, I think, is asking for trouble, even if it is a prescription glass.
Yeah, I think you did. You don't want to be that guy. And I think that what you did, Tim, is exactly how people who wear glass should treat it. It's, understand it's new, and people are funny about it. And don't wear it into the men's room. Because you know you can only tape 5 minutes of the movie doesn't let you off the hook.
I think you'd go to the ladies' room with them.
Jeez.
I didn't try that either, just for the record.
Just checking.
Somebody in the chat room says, you know, if it was Apple glass, Leo would be defending it.
I believe that's true. Whoever that said that is right on the money. And by the way, he should get kicked right now. Leo, get rid of him.
Leo would be defending it if we're Apple. That's why the Macintosh is sitting on the table, because I get that a lot Apple.
Too. What bothers me is that you didn't bring the real Mac, the new one, and I've been itching to check one out. I'm too lazy to go to the Apple Store.
You already stole my 5D Mark II. Now you want my Mac Pro?
No, I didn't. It's sitting over there where it was left. But I know that it exists with all these lenses. If I need to go do a professional shoot, I will borrow it.
Let me tell you something about the Mac Pro. They got problems with it. Okay. I love it. It's gorgeous. It's obviously overpriced.
You think so?
I talked to somebody. Well, you know what? This original Mac, costs the equivalent of almost $6,000 in modern money.
Dollars.
Yeah. So a $3,000 computer.
It's cheap. They're giving it away.
And I talked to somebody it restarts periodically. That's not good.
What?
Mine, the sound drops off. And then Bluetooth went away. I can't use my trackpad or wireless keyboard. I had to buy a wired keyboard because I just have no Bluetooth. I don't think these are hardware problems. I think it's Mavericks. Mavericks is known to have core audio
issues. You think it's the
so it's 10 OS. But I can't tell, so I just feel like I don't know. For
well, that's not a very good, now there you go, that's
a high recommendation.
That was a great commentary based on what these
but
people
if
in
Apple
the chat
made
room
glass
said.
I would buy it so fast.
No, you wouldn't. You know, I think you actually have a grudge against the company. I think this person in the chat room is completely off base. Because you...
Don't dig a hole for me, please.
What?
Please. I just beg of you. Clayton, great to have you. For how much longer will the gluten book, Why Gluten-Free, be available on Amazon?
Till midnight?
I think about another few hours, and then, it's free for another few hours. So go and grab it. And so many people already have who are watching Twit Live. So thank you so much to everyone who has and has already written a review. You guys are very, very kind. Thank you for
doing that. And you are now, they didn't update the rank.
Yeah, it's called Why Gluten-Free, if you missed it. Why Gluten-Free with a question mark.
If everybody who's listening to this show now goes and gets it, it's free.
Free.
Yeah.
Free gluten-free. You would be number one. So let's everybody do that right now.
Yeah, just grab it.
Thank you very much.
Just grab it. You don't have to read it. You don't have a Kindle.
Who cares?
Yeah. Yeah. I can lend you one. Just send it to Leo's 7th Kindle and I'll put it on. Or my 38th Android phone. Tim Stevens at CNET.com. Great to have you, Tim. What's next for you?
Next up for me, I think, is Mobile World Congress here in a couple of weeks out in Barcelona, so kind of gearing up for that, and still kind of clearing out my inbox after doing CES and the Detroit Auto Show back-to-back, so kind of fell behind on some things, so getting caught up on that and getting ready for Barcelona and looking forward to it.
I'm jealous you got to go to the auto show.
Yeah, it's always a lot of fun, but it's always exhausting because, you know, CES is a bit of a nightmare at times, and it's pretty exhausting, and you always get sick, and then to roll right into another show and straight to Detroit, keep running.
Wow.
It's just, yeah, especially when it's Detroit and it's 20 below.
Did you see anything of great interest at the car show?
Yeah. The new F-150 with the aluminum body is pretty exciting. Going to be up to 700 pounds lighter than before, which is massive. The new Corvette Z06 looks quite nice. It's faster than the old ZR1, which was a bonkers car to begin with. Definitely a lot of cool stuff. It looks like the market is definitely picking up a lot of steam. There's a lot of great cars coming out.
How about electric or hybrids? Are those really taking off or...
Well, we'll see how the BMW i3 does this year. They had a big presence at CES. It's going to be a very small car. I think it's going to be about $35,000 to start here in the U.S. Really nothing revolutionary in terms of technology, but certainly a nice-looking car, and it's a BMW, so it's got some, you know, it's named brand value behind it. But, you know, Tesla's still the leader in that sector right now. I think they'll continue to be for another year or two, at least.
Thank you, Tim, for being here. Thank you to John C. Dvorak, noagendashow.com. But, you know, before you go...
Yeah?
We should probably check to see if Mike Elgin's in the back with a report on what's ahead.
I don't see him.
Mike, the Silicon Valley giants report earnings this week. Oh. Apple Monday, Yahoo Tuesday, Facebook Wednesday, and Google Thursday. Amazon also has an earnings report Thursday. Plus, the Wearable Computing Technologies Conference starts in Munich on Monday, and the 3D Printer World Expo begins Friday in Burbank. Back to you, Leo.
Thank you, Mike.
Wait, I got to ask him a question.
Go ahead. Mike, wait a minute. John wants to ask you something.
Hey, Mike?
Go ahead, John.
That was Clayton. It was Clayton doing was Mike's voice.
That was very good.
Yes, John. And
John, you had a question. Go ahead.
If there's anything you missed this week on Twit, we've taken it all.
Oh.
We've rolled it up into a gluten-free ball.
Wait a minute.
And I'm going to...
This is a house ad.
Yes, it is. Huh. And I'm going to lob it at you right now.
Previously on Twit, Coding 101.
For the next 30 minutes, we're going to teach you everything there is to know about code so you are ready to be a code monkey.
Windows Weekly.
Stealth marketing, Microsoft paying YouTubers for Xbox One mentions.
The issue here was basically that these video bloggers, they're supposed to disclose that they're being paid to promote a product.
Tech news tonight.
A U.S. general says that as the army shrinks over the coming decades, robot soldiers will pick up the slack.
Tech news today.
HP is promoting Windows 7, saying that the 4-year-old OS is backed by popular demand.
I think the question is, can you at this point declare Windows 8 a flop?
This Week in Google.
If you really think that every man on Earth wants to shoot other men's junk, the only thing stopping them is they don't have a camera on their head.
No, that's not what we're saying. Really, if you go around with a tape recorder like this, people are going to take umbrage, and rightly
so. You're not. You're wearing glasses that have technology on it. Jesus, is this This Week in Ludditism?
Twit for justice.
For justice! Thank you. Have fun in Barcelona. I'm so jealous that you're going to get to go, Tim. Have a great time over there.
Thanks very much.
At Mobile World Congress, we'll be covering it as well. And thank you all for being here. We do Twit every Sunday afternoon, 3 p.m. Pacific. I don't know what we're going to do. When is the Super Bowl next week? You don't watch football, do you?
Never heard of it.
Why don't you come to we can watch the Super Bowl together.
I think I'm busy.
Is it like, it's after the show, right?
No. Isn't it going to be at 3
like
o'clock?
It's like 6 p.m. or it's like 5:30, 6 p.m. Eastern time.
Oh, we're
6
screwed.
P.m. Eastern, that's 3 o'clock. Right on the money.
So you don't want to watch the Super Bowl.
Why don't you
Twit
take the
week.
Day off? You make so
3
much money.
3 p.m. Pacific,
the
6
Just
p.m.
Just take it
Eastern
off.
Time.
Take the day off.
2200 UTC. Please watch Twit next week. The Super Bowl is going to be stupid.
Luckily, it's a podcast. People can download it and watch
it
later.
If you don't watch live, you can always get it after the fact. On-demand versions, audio and video available at twit.tv.
Absolutely.
What was I thinking?
I don't know.
You don't have to watch it. Watch the Super Bowl. Enjoy the game, and we'll see you next week. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you next time.
Amazing.
Oh, another twit is in the can. Right. 500 episodes, and I still don't have that ever.
Doing the twit, baby. Doing the twit. All right. Doing the twit, baby. Doing the twit. All right. Doing the twit, baby.
It's time for Twit This Week in Tech. Tim Stevens, John C. Dvorak, and Clayton Morris join us to talk about the week's tech news. There's lots to say, and we're going to say it now. Sorry.